Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
I want to welcome you this morning to another in the CEO series that we have sponsored by the corporate program, and I want to welcome all of you to this. I've been told to say two things at the outset. One, turn off your cell phones, and also the vibration part. Turn off those two. And so please do that now. And normally in these kinds of things, I'm always told to say this is off the record, but here I'm told to say this is on the record. So this conversation will be on the record, and no doubt it'll be in publications, Newsweek, probably in 1 minute or so after we're done. Right, Sydney?
Well, we published it last night.
Okay, all right. So what I'd like to do is initially introduce the speaker. I will he'll make a few opening remarks, and I'll have some questions, and then we have about a half hour reserved for questions from our members that are here. And this CEO series is designed to give people a sense of what it's like to be a CEO in modern corporate America or modern the corporate world. And the theory is that CEOs are increasingly people who have important impacts on public policy and also have great ideas about how the world might be improved in some respects. And therefore, we've tried over a number of years now to have some of the leading CEOs in the United States and the world, and we've done that. And we have one of those here today as well. Being a CEO is not that easy. And typically, we have public company CEOs in the United States last about 6 to 8 years or so. We don't really have people serving as CEOs for very long periods of time. Our guest today is somebody who served effectively as CEO for about 40 years of his company, so extraordinary length of time. But he's really something more than that. Mr. Premji, Azim Premji, who's the founder, really, of Wipro, served as effectively as CEO for about 40 years of his company. But more than that, he's a twofer in the sense that he's also the entrepreneur who really built the company. Rarely do you find somebody who has run a company that he's also built. Now, we have a couple of those, of course, in the United States. Bill Gates famously started the company and has run it, but that's very rare. But we also have a threefer in Mr. Premji in the sense that he's also taken another part of his life, like Bill Gates, and devoting an enormous amount of his time to philanthropy. And recently, he made a gift that was the largest single gift ever made in philanthropy in India, and I think the largest single gift made anywhere in the world last year. He gave $2 billion to his own foundation to purpose of improving Indian education. And he is somebody who is going to give away a large part of his net worth, which is quite considerable. He's one of the wealthiest men in the world. He started his career really like Bill Gates, dropping out of college. He dropped out of Stanford, but he dropped out in part because his father died, and he went back to run a very small family company that was really specializing in hydrogenated oils and cooking fats and things like that. But he transformed that over a 40-year period of time to one of the leading technology companies in the world, Wipro. It's a company that now has a market cap of about $24 billion. He owns about two-thirds of it. And it's a company that has revenues about $6.5 billion, serves in about 50, it works in about 55 different countries around the world. The principal sales actually come in the United States. And he has, in addition to doing that, he has spent a lot of his time over the years getting to know business people around the world. He's very active in a lot of business organizations, but recently devoted himself considerably to philanthropy. He set up his foundation a number of years ago, and it's a foundation that has enormous impact in India, but also around the rest of the world. And he's also done one thing that Bill Gates has not been able to do. He went back and got his college degree. He dropped out at Stanford, and 30 years later, he went back and got his Stanford electrical engineering degree. So Bill Gates has still something to catch up to you on doing. So we're very pleased that we have somebody today who's a CEO, an entrepreneur, and a great philanthropist. And what we'd like to do today is try to ask you a lot of questions about how you came to do what you did and what your vision is in the future. But let me start by just asking you if you might make a few opening remarks about some of the things you wanted to talk about, and then we'll get into questions, okay?
Thank you, David. You know, the problem with such introductions is, and I think I best quote my wife on it, she often tells me when she hears introductions like this, she says, Azim, for God's sake, I can't figure out how you ever achieve what you did achieve in life. You know, it's comments like those and comments like traveling economy in the United States which gets you really grounded down to life. I think they are very useful when you're successful because you happen to be in the right industry at the right time. You're successful because you're lucky. I mean, you cannot underestimate the value of luck and success in life. And I've really learned to appreciate that. You know, what I will just briefly talk to you about is more broadly I will talk to you about education in India, but my understanding is more of primary education in India, somewhat of secondary education in India, which is above standard 9 and 10. And the education which we focus on in the cities and, more importantly, in the villages of India. And within that context, it would be useful to cover initiatives which are there of public-private participation in India. Because we have a huge gap between what we need and what we are achieving, and a huge gap between what is supposed to be taught, particularly in primary education in the villages, and what is actually learned. And part of it is determined by poverty. But most importantly, it is determined by very, very shameful execution of education in the country. And that has improved, but it's not improving fast enough. You know, we are a country of 1.1 billion people. Education is accessible. There's a new act being passed, which is a Right to Education Act. There are about 227 million kids in up to secondary school. The number of students in primary school, that is up to standard 8, the dropout rates have very significantly fallen in the past 15 years. But even then, those dropout rates of approximately the 215 million children who are in primary education, the people, the boys and the girls who are not in school are 25 million. So you can see the scale. They have fallen, but they have fallen to 8, 9, 10%. And that is also reducing drastically. So that problem is going to get addressed, and it's by parental interference and availability of schools. But the frightening thing is that 35% of the children in primary schools up to standard 8, 35%, up to standard 5, cannot read or write. So, you know, you're talking about education, but you're not talking about measurement of education. You're not talking about quality of education. You're not talking about uniformity of education. And the sad thing is, you know, I spend time visiting villages. I spend time having the midday meal in villages. The sad thing is, you know, when you look into the eyes of the children, the boys and the girls, you're just terribly impressed in terms of how bright they are. And, you know, we have multiple languages. I cannot speak. I can speak English and I can speak Hindi. I can understand one or two other languages. So I use translators when I need to communicate and it translates back. So part of the feel is lost. Part of the gut is lost. But the quality of questions these kids ask, I wish our top management would ask in the country. Seriously, you know, I just find that the lower you go in life, the more intelligence and innocence there is, and more white sheet of paper in a mind there is in terms of the quality of students, the quality of questions which you get. I find quality of questions you get on a factory floor are far more intelligent than the quality of questions you get in an office. It's uniform right across. But this just speaks that these kids are bright, these kids are motivated, they want to make something of their life. Inherently, they are demanding of their teachers, which they are not getting, and they are ambitious, because media is available in a village. Even if a media of a TV is not available in a home, there's this concept of community homes, where a reasonably well-off villager will have a TV and a nice TV, and he'll keep it outside the house in the evenings, and there'll be a gathering of 20, 25 families, people, around the TV because they can't afford to have TV in their own home. So there's a huge amount of communication of what is happening in the rest of India, and the gaps between the standards they live and the standards lived by many people in the cities and by many people even outside the cities. In the villages, 90% and about 70% of India's population is in the villages. 90% of the schools in the villages are government schools. And they are run by 6.5 million teachers. These are all unionized. Because of the and they're each within the state. And because they're so heavily unionized, the teacher today is the best paid profession in a village. So there is no rationalization to say that you cannot hire, attract, and retain quality talent as village teachers. That's the least of the problems. But of these six, and I use very powerful things, is because this needs to come out in media. Of the 6.5 million children, of two teachers, at least 1 million teachers never attend school. They put in bogus attendance, and the union lets them get away with it. But the sad thing is that the community leaders, the community women, who should be the people with the maximum vested interest, are not pushing back enough to have this corrected. And we have so many effective laws like the Right to Information Act by which this thing could be pushed back and corrected quite quickly. The public-private partnerships are taking various forms in India. It is individuals who are socially oriented are setting up schools, they're setting up colleges, they're setting up universities. They're setting up primary education schools in the villages, particularly the villages their original families came from. And they get support for these schools in one form or the other, very often in terms of subsidized land and some recurring fees. In the engineering schools, it is much more for profit. There are partnerships in which a new initiative has been launched by the government, whereby they want to bring out about 2,000 or 3,000 schools as an experiment, where there's going to be a financial public-private partnership. It's not taken off as yet, and it's going through a process of review. There are partnerships such as we do very extensively. We work with the village schools, we work with the city schools, and what we do is see how we can lift standards, which we can talk about in the Q&A if you are interested. So we give professional, scaled help. With the result in our foundation now, we are involved in the villages of India, in 11 states of India, which represents about 55% of the population of India. And we are involved with about 27,000 schools. And we have involved with about 2.5 million children in our foundation. Similarly, in our company, Wipro Limited, because of our social initiatives, we are now involved with about 1,400 schools. And about cumulatively, we have covered about 1 million children. But our focus in our company is primarily to make the process of learning from standard 1 to standard 8 more interactive, more questioning versus pure rote learning. And we've been very successful because we work with about 32 partners in that. I think what we face as a country is a huge gap between demand and supply. And this is primarily in the area of school teachers. There's a huge shortage coming up of school teachers. The teaching institutes of teachers in India are just not adequate. They're not turning out enough volume, let alone the quality of the people that they turn out. Which is why, as a foundation, we have now decided to set up a university. It took us 2 years to get permission. We ask for nothing. We ask for no land. We ask for no subsidy. We ask for no capital. And we ask for no recurring grants. And setting up a university in India dedicated to teaching is a very expensive proposition, like most schools here also realize. It's not a for-profit business. And it will start in taking its students in about 4 months from now. But the focus of our university is to train education professionals. And with the ability to give degrees, we'll be able to attract talent. But we will bias a lot of our talent of recruitment of potential teachers who will give Bachelor of Ed degree, Master of Ed degree, and PhD degrees to students who come from poorer families, students who come from the villages, and students in whom we believe we can create a sense of mission to go back and teach. But more than 60% of the work of the university will be dedicated to training education professionals who are working with other schools, who are working with state governments, who are working in administrative positions in state governments, which oversee the education department of schools. And many of these we will be hiring into our own organization as we go forward, because we intend to scale from about 350 full-time employees now to about 5,000 employees and set up district centers, because we find that unless we are where the action is, we cannot have adequately effective intervention in upgrading the quality of learning and teaching which goes on in these schools. Broadly, these are some of the comments which I wanted to make.
Well, let me ask you, before we get into some of the substantive issues, you mentioned you're flying around on planes in the United States. Most people who have net worths of a $15 billion or so tend not to be flying economy class in the United States or in India. So why do you feel you can't have your own plane, and why do you not want to take some of your $15 billion and buy a plane and fly around a little bit more luxuriously? Why do you like the economy class?
Well, one is I don't want Obama on my back for it.
Okay. Well, in India, when you get on a plane and you're in economy class, so people must recognize you, I guess?
In India, yes.
They do. And
it's good for your brand.
Okay.
No, but actually, one does it because it's company policy. You can't set policy and you don't follow company policy.
But you make the company policy. But, right.
But second thing is, you know, I really think it gets you down to reality. I find too many rich people and too many rich chief executive officers have really lost part of the touch with reality. It's a point of view, so you would probably disagree. Right.
Well, maybe on one part of that, but on the flying around. But let me ask you, how did you go from, had to leave Stanford, your father died. You went back and you had a hydrogenated oils company, relatively small family company. How did you transform that into one of the largest technology companies in the world? What was the motivation to do so, and how did you actually transform the company?
You know, when the company, when I came on the scene, was about $4 million a year. It was a very small company, and it was in cooking fats, and it was in commodity cooking fats, which were sold to wholesalers, not sold to retailers, and therefore sold to consumers. I think the most important thing which we did was transform the company into a strong brand company, catering to the end user,
right?
Which gave you a very depth understanding of the whole process of marketing, because you had to work the streets. India has 21 million retailers who sell the products, 21 million retailers. So you can't sell products into the retail outlets unless you're visiting 45 shops a day in the villages of India in different parts of the country at different temperatures in the country, which can vary from 5 degrees to 45 degrees centigrade.
But did you have a technology background? I know you were studying engineering.
I had a background in electrical engineering. But I think the trigger point was that IBM left the country in 77. Because IBM in those days believed that they were trying to negotiate terms with the government. And we had a very strong industry minister who said that they have to bring current technology, which was fair. And they couldn't hold majority interest in the country because we had a limitation on majority control. And they tried to bargain with the government, and the government said no. So in protest, they left the country. And they were selling at that time in 77 unit record machines in India, which had been junked in the United States in the late 60s. They just created a huge opportunity of a vacuum.
I see.
And we were looking for a diversification which was affordable, which was service-oriented, which required after-sales service. We zeroed in on microprocessor-based mini computers.
And right now, your company is doing a number of things, software development, software services, but also so-called outsourcing. How do you respond to the argument that outsourcing by Indian companies has led to a reduction in jobs in the United States? I'm sure you've heard this. And what is your response to that?
You know, we are primarily an IT servicing company, similar to, say, Accenture to get a,
right.
Or IBM Global Services. You know, one is on an issue of philosophy, where I take objection to what is happening in terms of restriction. I think what you've seen happening in manufacturing, of globalization of manufacture, is happening in services, not just IT services, in globalization of services. You cannot globalize the experience of eating, but you can globalize many other areas of services, whether it's biotechnology, the IT services, whether it's legal services, whether it's accounting services.
Right.
So I think this is the next big wave. As it is the next big wave, I think the world must adjust itself that this is the next big wave. And if the Western world wants standards of liberalization for global trade, those standards of liberalization must extend just as much to manufacturing, to imports, to exports, as well as to servicing. So if the Western world tends to have one-way standards which suits them, I think we're asking for trouble in terms of emerging countries like India, China, Africa, putting up more significant tariff barriers on imports of hardware and products.
And who do you regard as your biggest competitors? Other Indian technology companies or American companies, Chinese companies? Where do you see the great competition coming from for your company?
Our prime competition is IBM and Accenture. And in terms of cost competition, China. China is cost competition in everything in the world. And IT is no exception because they produce as many engineers as we do. They're mathematical, they're ambitious. And manufacturing and R&D are getting more and more interlinked in location. So in the R&D services area, they can be right. Quite a major threat.
Now, a lot of prominent people...
But coming back to your original question in terms of jobs which are going lost to IT outsourcing,
right.
I think that's an important point. You know, if you just analyze over the past 10 years, the jobs lost to manufacturing in America are significantly, significantly higher than the jobs lost to services in America. If you look at the breakdown of unemployment rates, the breakdown of unemployment rates in the United States, and these are borne up by facts distributed by American authorities and American government authorities, is something like 1% to 2% unemployment rate among IT professionals. The biggest problem we have today operating in America, we have 9,000 people in America, resident in America, or on visas in America. About 35% of them are Americans. The biggest problem we have is recruiting talent in the United States. It's just not available.
Recruiting talent in the United States.
Including the talent in the United States.
Okay.
So we have really switched now to campus recruitment in the United States. You know, we have set up a state-of-the-art center in Atlanta, and we have recruited over the past 3 years, in the midst of the reset of the world, about 800 professionals.
I see.
85% of them are Americans, and 70% of them have been hired from local universities like George Tech, etc., putting them through an induction program of 3 through 6 months, and then making them part of our team. And we're going to repeat that in 2 more centers in the United States in the next 1 year.
Now, many prominent Indian business people in the United States have chosen not to move back to India. You chose to move back. Why do you think so many people from India who are educated in the United States often stay here, start companies? I think one-third of the companies in Silicon Valley are now said to be owned by people from India. Do you see a trend where Indian students are now going to go back to India, or are they going to stay in the United States more?
I think most certainly more Indian students will go back. They'll go back for 2 reasons. One is the opportunities. And the quality of the jobs that they can get there in terms of technology they can be working on, which is a motivation for technical people. 2 is the compensation levels in India have reached a level now whereby you can afford a good standard of living in India if you're educated and are employed by a good company. But at the more senior level, people are very well settled here. They're happier. America is an open country, irrespective of the needling that has happening on visas.
Right.
And their children are used to America. You know, I have a sister living in Halifax. She has 4 children. None of them want to go back to India because their whole life they have grown up in Canada.
Now, when you wrote a check for $2 billion, did you mention it to your wife you were going to give away $2 billion? And what did she say and your children say? And was it hard to write that $2 billion check?
I suppose they were supportive of it. You know, we have a little different philosophy. You know, there's a limit to greed.
Right. Okay. So how did you happen to pick education of the many things that are needed in India? Why did you pick education versus other things as the focus of your philanthropy?
First, you have to have a focus. You know, I just believe if you don't have a focus, you're spreading yourselves too thin. We chose education because we saw the gaps there. It's just absolutely shocking what was happening. And education has a very interesting multiplier effect. One is it's a process of building a country. It's a process of building a nation. Because you build, if you're successful, young boys and young girls who can be better leaders, better citizens, right, better integrity, better responsibilities towards their country, their fellow people. Equally important, we found that the girl child, even if she's educated up to about standard 8, standard 9, standard 5, standard 6, when she grows up, she has a smaller family. So immediately you attack, parallelly, the concept of smaller families and more affordable families. And you see this correlation all over the world. And you see this correlation in higher educated states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu,
right,
which have much smaller families. And three, the girl child, again, when she's educated, is much more open to primary health care and disciplines of primary health care.
And how do you compare in your own life the relative pleasures of building a company and the relative pleasures of giving away money? Where do you see the greater challenge and the greater pleasure?
Much greater challenge in giving away money. Particularly if you're clear that you want to use it well, particularly if you're clear that you don't want to be writing checks to other people. Other people, I mean, you know, other foundations which are large and scaled and don't need your checks. Or particularly if you don't want to give donations to government because we believe that money is not well used. So you have to build things from scratch. And it's very complex.
And today,
you have to build things to scale which get institutionalized. So you become irrelevant in it very soon.
And you are going to focus on some other things in your philanthropy other than education. Have you decided what other things you're going to do other than education?
Probably next step will be elements of primary health care at a village level.
Okay.
Because the two things go very much one-to-one.
Now, India is a country
which is
growing. Its economy is growing. It's one of the bigger economies in the world, and it's obviously growing. But per capita, the income is very low, relatively speaking. Do you see any fundamental change in India's per capita income and the elimination of some of the enormous poverty in India over the next 10 or 20 years, or you think that's just too far into the future to predict?
No, without question, it'll happen. I think, irrespective of our governments, the economy will grow at 8%. I think the nice thing about India is it's become a bit like Italy. We function irrespective of our governments. So the economic engine has enough momentum in it. And there's a huge amount of entrepreneurship there, really a huge amount of entrepreneurship. You see it in Indians who come to the United States. Yourself made the statement that one-third of the startups are by people of Indian origin.
Now, have you been influenced by the activities of Bill Gates and Warren Buffett in your philanthropy, or they had no real influence, you were going to do this anyway, or what kind of impact do you think they've had?
I know both of them, and I have enormous respect for both of them. I think they're taking a message to the world which is a useful message, and I think they made some fairly interesting penetration in the United States. If their presence in India on 24th of March, and I'm on the panels with them on this issue.
I think if you
keep repeating and repeating and repeating this, and keep demonstrating and demonstrating and demonstrating this, it does have an effect.
But in in India, philanthropy is not quite as well entrenched, let's say, as it is in the United States. Why do you think that is the case, and do you see a real change in India occurring?
One is because there's no estate duty law in India. It was there. It was withdrawn many, many years back. So the fact that estate duty takes a huge chunk in the United States is no longer there in India. You can leave the entire estate completely intact. Two is I think there's a much more cultural feeling in India, much more culture aspect in India, that you have to leave your wealth to your family, your immediate family. And there's an expectation from the family that that will happen. Most people are just not breaking away from it.
What would you take from your business career as the most important life lessons? In other words, if you were going to talk to some students and give them advice about what they can do to have a successful career such as yours, what would you say are the one or two most important life lessons you've taken from your own career?
My own life lessons?
Yes.
Modesty. Two is, you learn more from failure than you learn from success, provided the failure teaches you a lesson.
Right? It's not...
And luck is very important.
And you wouldn't say it's the color of your hair, which I've always thought was such an important success indicator, no? No?
It was a funny thing. When I first came on the scene, I was 21 years old. And I had to color my hair white because nobody would take me seriously.
I've had the same problem, but we have time for some questions from our members. What I'd like you to do is get a microphone, stand up if you would, identify your affiliation and your name, and then ask the question to Mr. Premji. So, right here, we have a question.
Thank you, Mr. Premji. I'm Joel Cohen from Rockefeller and Columbia Universities in New York City, and I applaud what you're doing for primary education. Would you address the question of nourishing the child so that the child can learn when he or she gets to school? I'm concerned about problems of undernutrition and whether your primary health care plans will address questions of nutrition of children.
You know, what we want to now influence, and we want government to pay for it. There's a very interesting scheme in India in as part of education, which I think is now being repeated by many other countries in the world, of a free midday meal by the government schools. And it's part of the whole budget. And it's a significant part of the whole budget. And it's a decent meal, because many companies like us, or many foundations like us, have got involved in community advocacy on it, so that the meal gets supervised by the women when it is being cooked and when it is being served. It's localized and being cooked, so the ingredients are centrally shipped. And it's a decent meal, because I've had that very often. It's a simple meal, it's a vegetarian meal, but it's a balanced meal, because we have a lot of lentils in India. And that, combined with vegetables, is a decent meal. But what is required is a supplement of some vitamins, which help in just a balance of what the body requires, which is often very absent. And that's what we want to influence. That is part of the midday meal budget, put this in. And if they don't agree to putting this into the budgets, influence policy at a senior level, push back from the villages at a senior level, push back from leadership at a senior level, to be able to achieve this. That's one element of extra hygiene in the midday meal for the child. The second area is in the area that of sanitation standards and health standards of cleanliness, which one very often does not find, which is again educating the village mother, the importance of that for the little children which are in the house, the newborn child which is going to be there, and generally a discipline that, you know, you don't take the garbage from your house and throw it into the neighbor's garden, which sometimes happens, and issues which are related to that. The third area of involvement would be in very, very poor families. How do we get involved in a much more deep manner? We're trying to figure that out, because we just got our hands terribly full of trying to do what we are doing and now trying to get this university up and about, because we have set very tight deadlines on it. And we will work much more actively with organizations such as the Bill Gates Foundation. We are in dialogue with them, because they're doing some good work at a grassroots level, and so are other companies. But what we got to be careful of is not a very close association with multinationals as a foundation, because it just takes all kinds of side things when somebody wants to hit you in terms of opposition, which Muhammad Yunus is facing now in Bangladesh, and very seriously, because I just talked to him 4 or 5 days back. And we are very, 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 very careful that we are very low-key. So all the work which we do, we give the credit to the state authorities, the state bureaucrats, and the state politicians, because generally they're doing the good work. And generally, the people who work with us are the people who really stand out in terms of a conviction to do good work. And it makes no difference to us, and we get their support going forward. We don't want that to get diluted with the politics. You know, we can take on the unions for getting teachers to attend school. But once you take on the union, then you have 6.5 million teachers in unions. You cannot fight them. It's not practical. So you have to build a cultivated sense of insensitivity to that, that living with some of the mess.
And by the way, are your children involved in your philanthropy?
My elder son, yes. My younger son worked in our foundation for 2.5 years, full time.
Okay. And your other son is in your company?
He's in our wealth management company, the okay. private company.
Okay, other questions here?
Yeah. My name is Ali Jaffrey. I'm with Prudential Douglas Elliman Real Estate. I feel very blessed to be here. And I'd just like to say that the person that you are being is so incredible. If we could have CEOs that are more like you, this world would be a different place. You're very inspiring. My question is that, you know, you stated some points on how, you know, what we can do to become like you. What other advice would you give? I'm sure that you've been through a lot in your life. Have you had mentors throughout your life? Are there any other, you know, points that you can share with us that that can inspire us? Anything you can share with us that would help?
A very broad question.
In other words, how do you make $15 billion? And you can do that in 5 minutes. You could summarize that.
Thank you.
You know, I think the most important thing, and I find that in recruiting for leadership, whether it be in the foundation, because I'm quite involved in selecting leadership, because you've got good people, 60% of your job is done, is you must get people who have some sense of mission, you know, which is deep and unshakable. Really, it's very important. We have a lot of confidence in themselves, which is also very important, because leaders are always facing hurdles and they're always facing failures. You have to have that confidence to be sustaining and to be tenacious and to go on and on and on, because things come and get results when you go on and on and on. In primary education, it's most difficult because it's so frustrating. And I can imagine if it's so frustrating for me, how frustrating it would be for our chief executive officer who's on the road 150 days a year in the villages of India. That's not like traveling to New York. It is rough. Our women employees find it so hard to get decent accommodation. And the Indian system is still of ragging women who are deep in the villages. But they still have so much dedication. And three is believe in yourself. You know, it's very important. Because if you don't believe in yourself, how do you expect other people to believe in you?
What technology companies in the world do you most admire, other than your own?
No, I don't admire my own company the most, unfortunately. Otherwise, you get complacent, don't you?
So there's no one that you want to cite as something as a role model or a great technology company that you really admire the way they've built their business?
Different phases, different companies. Microsoft did it at one stage. It was quite remarkable, business and technology. Google has done it, which is quite exceptional. At this point of time, the one which seems to be having the maximum momentum and the maximum innovation and creativity seems to be Apple. It's a technology company.
And is Facebook a big company in India? Is that a big deal in India?
It will become big. It will become very big.
Okay. Other questions? In the back, all the way in the back, person with the beard.
Person with the beard. Okay.
Right.
Thank you. Mr. Premji, one of the things which I feel is you make us very proud as people of Indian origin. My question to you is, you focused on education. There are many parts of India, the tribal places, where they don't have any access to means of transportation to even get to a school. I know of a religious leader from India, Swami Dayananda, who's setting up 600 institutions to get these people to come and live in those places so they can go to school. Do you have any prospects of collaboration, cooperation with the religious institutions? I'm a product of a religious school from India, run by the Church of England, which was great. And so I think some of the religious folks are doing incredible work in education. I wonder if you do that. Second part linked to this is Mr. Mittal of Airtel is also doing with schools. Can you, as the country's leading billionaires, somehow form some kind of a cooperation system to have even out the education play field so that, you know, there's consistency in sharing with each other? And do you propose in the future to get some of the leading educators from the institutions in America to go to India and teach with them, because that'll make it more, even play field?
You know, the first question, your facts are not correct. Today, 90% of village schools are within a commute distance in one form or the other, a village handcart a village rickshaw which takes in 20 kids in a rickshaw meant for three people, are within a, and it's not expensive because if you share that rickshaw cost by 20 people, it's very cheap. It's within 30 minutes, which is fair. And that will also change. The schools are coming up all over the place. And one area where we must give credit to government where credit is due. I think the more serious problem, which is, again, very easy to fix, is toilets in village school. And that becomes very awkward for the girl child when she reaches puberty. And quite a number of girl children fall out from school just because of this. And all it requires is, as part of the approved budget of the government, prioritize that in terms of the capex, the physical assets which are going into the school. I think that will be fixed is because we are putting a lot of pressure on it. And other people are putting a lot of pressure on it. The third question was that you should be working collaboratively with other people who have interest in schools like Mittal or Bharti. We do. In fact, you know, he's visiting us 2 weeks from now. We want to leverage other people. And we want to encourage these other people, such as Bharti, to scale. We want them to see whether they can learn something from us. We want to see whether we can learn something from them. So part of our rollout of scaling to a much larger scale than 2.5 million children, we'd like to go to 10 million children in the course of the next 5 years, is to work collaboratively with NGOs and industrialists and other social entrepreneurs to see whether as a group we can be more scaled and as a group we can have higher standards. Okay. You know, we do a very interesting program. Let me do a little selling on the programs we do in Wipro also. This is getting too personalized. We did a very interesting program which we launched 2.5 years back of called Mission 10X for engineering schools. You know, today, between 28 and 30% of the 650,000 engineers who graduate in India, engineers who graduate in India, U.S. has 75,000 engineers which graduate in the United States, are not employable by the technology industry because the standards are not high enough, because the curricula is not current enough. But the kids are bright enough, okay, because engineering draws the best talent. So we committed 2.5 years back, and we dedicated 20 full-time professors to this from our training institute, Wipro, that we will train 10,000 professors in 2 years. We did it in less than 2 years. We just made a commitment now that we will train another 20,000 further professors in 2 years by bringing them to our campus, by sending our campus teachers to them, and by completely redoing the curriculum and training the teachers in terms of technology, training the students in terms of technology. It's a very involved amount. We use a lot of physical training and a lot of electronic training. Now we have decided to open up all our material, all our courseware, all our software to competition because we have no claim on these students to hire them. But the way we look at it is that if we can get even 5 of our leading competitors to do the same thing, we can convert within the next 3 years the ratio of hiring from engineering students, 3 to 5 years, from 25% to 30% to 40 to 45% and then to 50%. So we have suddenly doubled our pool of talent. Our vested interest is that you get better students, you spend less money in inducting them, and 3, you solve the problem of unreasonable salary escalations.
Okay. Here, question.
John Watts of the World Policy Institute. Thank you for a very inspiring talk, and I'm very much admiring what you're doing in education, secondary and primary. I think if you get problems in India sorted out, you might help us with some of the ones we have here in those areas. I have a question about is there a conjunction or an intersection between technology and the problems of connecting with the families of children, particularly in villages? Is it useful? Are there enough devices, enough education, enough resources to use computers as a link in that work?
I think the most powerful media of communication will be the TV, because there's a habit of watching the TV. And if you can interface programs on education into popular programs of TV, which generally get watched, or if you can have dedicated programs which you're able to market in terms of how does a person improve his life skills, how does he improve his income levels, how does he prepare himself to prepare better for the examination, the media can be very powerful, and that media is available. But with broadband coming more and more, it'll come across the country very soon. There's no physical limitation to it. I think it can be used very interestingly for education programs, and which are much more interactive.
What do you wish most Americans knew about India that they don't know? And what do you see as the greatest misconceptions about India in America?
You know, I find Americans who have visited India, you know, not morning in Bombay and leaving Bombay in the evening, but who have spent maybe even a week, 10 days in India, and tried to move into few cities in India, not necessarily even into villages in India, come back with a reasonably good feel of India. They're smart, you know, they're sensitive, they listen to people. I think the misconception of Americans is they speak too much from a pedestal. You know, I don't think they have the diplomacy of the Europeans.
Right.
It would really help if you all had some of the diplomacy of the Union. You know, the Europeans are screwing us on visas anyway,
right.
But they're doing it with more style.
Okay. Right. Okay, well, it's a lesson we'll take into account. In terms of one geopolitical question, maybe you're not the expert on it, but people will be interested in your views. Are most Indians today still worried about invasions from Pakistan or any kind of tension with Pakistan, or is that receded?
No, I don't think we're worried about invasion from Pakistan. I don't think Pakistan is left with any strength to invade a country like India. They would be desiccated overnight if they did that. In fact, what is containing them is any precipitation of war from India, because they see the consequences of it. I think what is very, very concerning is the systematic terrorism which is building up in Pakistan. I was recently with our home minister. Their biggest problem, and I was asking him, what is the solution to this? He says, Azim, our biggest problem is we don't know who to deal with. We just don't know who to deal with. So it is very difficult to pin down anything. And two, within Pakistan, what is happening is that the Muslim fundamentalist groups are becoming more and more powerful. So it is worrying everyone because they tend to be extreme. And simultaneously, the extent of unemployment among young boys and girls is going up. That's the biggest festering of dissatisfaction and terrorism.
Now, your country is actually one of the largest Muslim countries in the world, maybe the second largest. Do you see
after Indonesia.
Right?
After Indonesia.
Yeah, after Indonesia. Do you see Muslim fundamentalism being a big issue in India or not as much as in other countries?
No, it's a non-issue in India.
Non-issue, okay.
What is an issue in India is that the Muslim community, for one reason or the other, and there are some social reasons for it, is falling behind in education. So they should not fall behind on a continuous basis, and unless something is done about them, they become a group which becomes like the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, which becomes a group which, you know, then have to go more extreme steps of reserving jobs for them, doing more statutory things for them.
Okay. Question here, right here. Yes, ma'am.
Margaret Osmer McQuaid, Asian Programs Foundation. You mentioned about the input your foundation's having on the curriculum at the university level. I wondered how you feel about curriculum content for primary and secondary schools and whether it's possible for you to have input, or is that pretty tightly controlled by the government?
It is very controlled by the government. It is also very controlled by the government because many of them have book publishing organizations. So there's an indirect nexus. But it is changing. We are working very hard on that to change curricula. In fact, we are working very hard in our foundation to permit skill training after Standard 8 as part of the curricula. Because if you don't start introducing skill training to equip young boys and girls to go into jobs, which are coming up, you're going to get a large group of children who get more educated but become educated unemployed. And that can be a very, very serious problem of unrest because the aspiration levels have gone up. And what are the skills? You know, you're talking about motor mechanic, you're talking about plumbers, you're talking about masons, you're talking about carpenters, you're talking about people who can service simple electronic equipment, TVs. And there's a huge number of jobs coming up, which we need. And there's a huge shortage of this because of various schemes, the farm laborers from the other villages, from the other states is not coming in. And this is what Germany did very successfully. And it's not difficult to do. So we are now trying to get this much more into the curricula, and we wanting to equip ourselves is how do we build expertise as a foundation, working with who, to be able to help in this transformation taking place. But it's very critical, according to me.
Okay, other questions? Sydney?
I'm Sidney Harmon, the founding chairman of Harmon International and currently employed as the chairman of Newsweek magazine. Comment you made earlier prompted me to remember a wonderful aphorism offered by our great poet, Robert Lowell, to the effect that the human being, said he, is an astonishing instrument, turns on automatically when we get out of bed in the morning, does not turn off until we get to the office. You commented on how bright the people working within the company are, and it's my thought that in terms of education, great opportunity for leverage is schooling on company premises, company cost. And the opportunity that is so rich there for the parents of the kids to learn, to develop great respect for learning and education, and to see that as leverage with their children, the next generation. I wonder whether you'd comment on that.
No, you're saying education being given to the child within a corporate environment?
Given to the employees within the corporate environment, at corporate cost, corporate premises, because the parent thus developing his own sense of the value of learning provides a level of leverage for students for their children.
You know, very interestingly, the schools which have come up by families, are very biased towards this. They give teaching to children of the families working in the company. It has a double purpose. It builds deep relationships of loyalty. And they get the next generation of employees coming up from this. And they run it to very high standards. So many schools, apart from schools coming up near their villages, which was their parental villages, many schools of the families which are now setting up new schools are also in a way linked to the corporates and businesses which they have set up, particularly because Indian policy incentivates schools to be set up in very far-off non-cities to make it commercially viable. They give incentives. So the schools, the industry is coming up where education facilities are not up to a standard which a professional would like to have. But just to take off on that, you know, in our engineering business, we introduced a program for English learning for the workmen, the unionized worker. And it's the most popular program growing. And it's on their time, it's not on our time. And the reason is that they have gone to a salary level, which is attractive. The kids are well educated. The kids' children come over to their homes and start speaking in English. And they don't understand English and they feel small. So they are on a crash course to learn English so that they don't look like fools in the home as compared to their friends of their children. And it's the most popular course. So, you know, there are lots of innovations you can build around this, whereby you can be giving something which is very practical, which is not in a conventional school, but really enhances the learning of the employee. But I think it'll be more interesting if you're able to extend it to his wife, where she doesn't have access to certain learning, where if she had access to certain learning, she could have been a better parent. She could have looked after the house differently. She could have perhaps done a part-time job working from home, issues like that. So I think it's very interesting possibilities there. They're not very expensive.
Let me take the privilege of the last question. What would you like to see as your great legacy in life? What would you like to see as the legacy that you, while you'll be with us for a long time, leave behind? Is it your philanthropic activities, your business activities? What would you like people to remember the most about you?
I think the most of value I'd like people to remember was that I did the best in whatever I was doing. It's a very important sense of self-satisfaction to me.
Okay. Thank you. Obviously, we've heard this morning from an extraordinary individual in business and philanthropy, and we're very pleased and proud that you were here, and thank you very much. On March the 22nd, the chairman of Nestle, Peter Brabeck, will be here, and on March 30th, the CEO of AT&T, Randall Stephenson, will be here. We hope you can attend. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.